here at OU. A little bit about our cast of characters here. I'm Arvid Ashby. I'm on the faculty of the musicology area at Ohio State, up to the north a bit. And our performers are Kimberly Monson, who is faculty at Baylor. Kimberly actually got her doctorate from Ohio State, so that's a connection with her. Kat Rohrer, who is head of the vocal department at OSU. She's our mezzo. And then Dr. Jung Yoon, recently appointed part of the full-time faculty as well at Ohio State. So we're all basically coming down from the north here to present Mahler to you this evening. Actually, specifically, what we're doing here is giving you two song sets. I don't call them song cycles because actually only the Lieder eines Fahrenden Gesellen is a true cycle. It has one particular defined order of songs. The Rückert Lieder basically can be performed in any order. Mahler didn't have any particular set order for those, so I use the word song sets. We have two song sets for you today. The Fahrenden Gesellen songs are earlier Mahler, written mostly when he was in his mid to later 20s, and the Rückert Lieder are when he was turning about 40. So early-ish and late-ish two cycles here for you this evening. So a little bit about Mahler. I'm going to do, before each of the cycles, I'm going to stand up here and talk a little bit, maybe about 8 minutes or so before the first cycle, first set, and then come back and talk a little bit before the second. So that's our sort of way of dividing this up. So Mahler, I recently wrote a book on Mahler. It's called Experiencing Mahler, makes a great Christmas gift. buy a copy, I'll make 10 cents, it'll be great. That's a joke. In writing the book about Mahler, I quickly realized that writing about Mahler, summarizing Mahler, is very, very difficult, first of all, because there's been so much that's been written and said about Mahler, that it's very difficult to sort of find a foothold on the subject. But also trying to summarize what is different about Mahler. Why is Mahler important? What does his music do that has such an impact on people? And why you can easily fill concert halls with Mahler. Nowadays, I think we've reached a point where if you want to sell a concert out of an orchestra performance program Mahler, and you're most likely to sell all of your tickets. So what is it about Mahler exactly? And I finally reached the conclusion that Mahler has this almost insane intensity of expression. Mahler just overflows with meaning. Mahler's music is just packed with almost too much meaning, and I think that's one reason why it tends to grab us so strongly. And then when we deal with the song sets, in his songs, even more than in the symphonies, I think, where in the songs we have, of course, words present. And so in the songs, even more than the symphonies, I think Mahler asks the big question most prominently about how music can hold, embody, and convey meaning. So it's with the songs by Mahler we really hit this issue very strongly. So Mahler himself changed his answers to this question about how music can be meaningful. As he approached the turn of the century, as he approached his 40th birthday, he actually abandoned ideas of literal meaning, pictorial meaning, programmatic meaning, this kind of clear-cut sort of verbatim idea that you have a sound in the world, you convey it, you mirror it, you represent it in the music, the connection is clear. He really kind of jettisoned that idea and became more abstract in some ways. He distanced himself as he changed over to this later part of his career, distanced himself from narrative and dramatic musical illustration. And here, actually, the Fahrenden Gesellen songs I'm going to present as an example of this kind of dramatic music, this kind of music that tells stories in a way that the Rückert Lieder do not. So our two contrasting song sets tonight here, and here's Mahler at work. This is at a desk in Rome. I think he's actually conducting in Rome. I think he's actually As you probably know, Mahler was an extremely busy conductor as well as composer, and I think here he's actually working through some conducting scores for an engagement and sort of taking a moment to stare off in the distance for the camera. So there he is, I guess in his later 30s. So here are the earlier and later Mahler song sets we're talking about with their dates. So our two contrasting song sets here tonight demonstrate this dualism between narrative, storytelling, clear-cut, meaningful conveyance, and the later songs being something more abstract. First, we have the Lieder eines fahrenden Gesellen, translates most often to songs of a wayfarer, maybe more literally, songs of a traveling youth, songs of a wayfaring youth, wayfaring lad. These he wrote, he was a struggling musician in his 20s, very busy conducting, but very much still unsettled in his life situation. And then the group of songs to text by the German poet Friedrich Rückert, which he penned at that point as a musician of means and by then international profile in 1901 to 1902. So these are two divergent song sets from two different points in his career, two different perspectives on music, and two different perspectives really on life itself. So I want to start off by using a word that Mahler himself used to try and differentiate between these two different kinds of songs and different kinds of music making, and that word is lyric. In talking with the younger composer Anton Webern, Webern's music you might know was a young student of Arnold Schoenberg's, and Mahler sort of hung out with these young Viennese composers, and this might have been in a kneipe somewhere in a tavern, and Mahler was talking with these young composers and students, and Mahler was talking to Webern and said to him, Rückert's poetry was a quintessential example of lyric poetry. And here's the quote, Mahler talking to Webern. Mahler said, "After this Knabenwunderhorn, all I could do was Rückert. It's first-hand lyric poetry. Everything else is second-hand lyric poetry." Close quote. So, in this turn to lyric texts, in his last decade of songwriting, Mahler was really aligning himself with a more sort of new and maybe more modern kind of experience and idea of musical world-making. So what does this word lyric mean exactly? It's actually that Mahler chose to emphasize so much here. It's actually a difficult word to define, and how Rückert embodies the idea of lyric poetry is another question. So the word lyric actually has a long history. You can go back to Aristotle. Aristotle differentiated between three different kinds of poetry. Aristotle said there's epic poetry, dramatic poetry, and lyric forms of poetry. In the first of those, in epic poetry, you have storytellers telling lengthy tales of the past, grand stories of conquest, traveling, and adventure. In the second, in dramatic poetry, you have characters acting out their own involvements in the present. And then, in lyric forms, you have a first-person self describing their own subjective sphere of experience. So lyric, that's sort of the inside person looking out at the world, very self-preoccupied. That is the lyric kind of persona. So the lyric style maybe is more of a stance further on in life. The lyric style accords with a more centered philosophical stance that comes with age. Supposedly you get older, you get more philosophical. While the epic and dramatic are more sympathetic to the self-centered dramatics of youth, people at college age, for example. And the young Gustav was indeed a mass from day one of manic, depressive, emotional shifts. Not an easy person to be with or to live with. His friend Natalie Bauer-Lechner, who knew Mahler well in his mid-20s through his 30s, remembered how spending time with Gustav and with his moods was much like, as she described it, being in a canoe with someone who's thrashing around and threatening to turn the canoe over and send everyone into the water. So the verge of tipping everything over, that was Mahler as a personality. So Mahler, the boat tipper of emotions, must have heard Lieder actually as a boy before he heard any kind of orchestral music, or before certainly he heard any opera. So one imagines that Mahler, this very emotional young man, must really latch onto the single trained voice in the model of Lieder composition. So Mahler mentioned in the statement to the young Anton Weber, he mentioned Des Knaben Wunderhorn. Here's the title page for this. You can see the youth's magic horn, old German songs. So Mahler was especially drawn to this collection of folk-like texts that Achim von Arnim and Clemens Brentano had published in 1805 and 1808 under this title of the youth's magic horn. Now, Mahler said he was very much sympathetic to those texts. What are those texts like of that collection? Well, they're charming, they're morbid, they're grotesque, they're old-style folkloric poems, and they were deeply influential on all of Mahler's music up until he shifted his stance about 1901. So these Knaben Wunderhorn, you might know Mahler's songs, his own songs setting the text of this Knaben Wunderhorn. There are quite a few of them, actually. So the texts here that Mahler set there are as much character studies as they are about actions and emotions. So characters, doomed soldiers, Der Tambour Gazelle, you might know that song. Doomed soldiers, drummer boy, in that case, going to the gallows, he's about to be executed, and he's recounting this in his own words. Starving children, das irdische Leben, starving child who's on the verge of death from starvation and keeping to crying out to his mother, thresh the wheat, bake the bread, and just as she pulls the bread out of the oven, the child dies. Yearning lovers, wandering pilgrims, Urlicht is an example of that. These are mini dramas, the Knaben Wunderhorn songs, usually grotesque, eerie, tensely satirical, often harrowing in their portrayals of death and the approach to death and the tragedy of death. But as readers, we are made just as aware of specific protagonists telling tales as we are of the actions taking place. So the Lieder on das Fahnen Gazellen, title page over here on the right, and this is the first song set on our program tonight that Catherine Rohrer will sing for us. These were Mahler's first published song collection. The texts here, the Fahnen and Gazelle songs, are his own. He wrote these words himself, but wrote them in Knaben Wunderhorn poetic style. So he was influenced by Knaben Wunderhorn, wrote his own texts, and then arranged those texts, those songs, in something like the overall narratives that Schubert and Schumann had popularized in their great cycles, Die Schöne Müllerin, Winterreise, and Dichterliebe. And what is that narrative in those song cycles? Also influential on Mahler. The heartbroken lover setting out for places unknown and ultimately meeting a dark fate, presumably death itself. So the Fahnen and the Gazelle songs are first-person lovesick narratives modeled on the great early century song cycles by Schubert and Schumann, but with an added dose of self-pity thrown in, and some of the quirks and rustic local color of the Wunderhorn texts sort of added in for spice. And Gustav Mahler, the eternal emotional boat rocker, is everywhere present. At times, I think, in these songs, he comes very close to tipping us all, singer and listeners, overboard into the river of unbridled emotion. So here are the four Fahnen der Gazelle songs, 1884 to 1885. Wenn mein Schatz Hochzeit macht, when my darling has her wedding day, ging heute Morgen ihres Feld, I went out this morning onto the meadow. Ich habe ein glühend Messer, I have a glowing knife. And the last, die zwei blauen Augen, the two blue eyes of my beloved. So the Sekir begins with the song, Wenn mein Schatz Hochzeit macht. Here the jilted lover is telling us how he dreads the day that his beloved will marry someone else. The song obsessively repeats a lilting but minor key rhythmic figure that suggests interrupted celebration with its back and forth swing between tempos quicker and slower. That's what Mahler writes in the score. The narrative here ponders a wedding dance, but realizes that someone else will be doing the dancing. The celebrating groom, not the poet, not the singer, will be celebrating. And then he envisions his own sad retreat from these festivities. Geh in mein Kammerlein, I'll go to my little room and weep. Empathetic nature arises momentarily as a solace. Blumlein blau, little blue flower. But then leaves spring and all its attendant hopes behind. Sing it nicht, bluet nicht, do not sing, do not bloom. So it ends with complete sadness. In the second song of the set here, Gegenheit Morgen Übersfeld, the narrator here is distracted. This is the most cheerful opening, I think, of all the songs. The narrator is distracted by the morning loveliness of nature as a metaphor for spiritual renewal. So the poet, the singer, is going out in the morning. It's a beautiful day. The sun is out. There's dew on the grass. Everything is good. Everything is fine with life. The song is brisk and regular as befits a cheerful morning jaunt. The good cheer is such that the narrator actually lets out a spontaneous hiya and bids the world good morning. So such good cheer. But then finally, of course, this being Mahler, he gets his cruel comeuppance for having such optimism. Nun fand auch mein Glück wohl an, nein, nein, dass ich mein, mir nimmer blühen kann. Will my good fortune also now begin with this beautiful day? No, no, it can never bloom for me. And that's the end of the song. So, not a cheerful ending to a cheerfully beginning song. The third song, Ich habe ein glühend Messer, here the cycle, the set takes a darker turn even, turning towards despair here. No longer an agent of nature, emotion here becomes a knife in my breast. Ein Messer in meine Brust, a sharp and red-hot blade that cuts so deeply, schneidet so tief. A vision of the beloved gives momentary distraction from these incisions into the soul. So, wenn ich in dem Himmel sehe, when I look up at the sky. But the song ends with a despairing, black, magniloquent, utter collapse into the blackest minor mode. Ich wollte, ich leg auf der schwarzen Bar, if only I were on my black beard. So, in other words, if only I were dead. It's a little over the top. So the fourth and last song, Die zwei blauen Augen, actually grants that wish for death. So the poet, the singer, says subjunctively at the end of number three, if only I were lying at my own funeral. So the fourth song grants that wish. It presents itself as a funeral march. Right, Mahler and his funeral marches. A poet striding out into the world with trudging towards the grave. As in Schubert's Winterreise, the walking journey becomes terminal. And the promised escape from love becomes an outing unto death. Like Schubert's protagonist, this heartsick journeyer has arrived in town in springtime, at the start of the song cycle. Fallen in love, hope for marriage, but now in the dead of night, haunted by painful memories and remorse, leaves town for an indefinite destination. A destination that we come to realize, is actually the grave. So in the third stanza of the last song here, the heartbroken lover lies beneath a linden tree, lies on the ground, and finds rest for the first time in sleep. Da hab ich zum ersten Mal im Schlaf geruht. So, sleep. The song and the final Gazelle song set as a whole then ends with a return to the halting funeral march, now with no response of words in the human voice. So clearly, or maybe not entirely so clearly, our heartbroken lover has found an eternal state of rest in namely death. So to summarize, Mahler here is setting epic and dramatic texts in the Faun de Giselle songs, fairly early Mahler from his 20s. He presents us with utterances by caricatures or stock characters, the forlorn, heartbroken lover, and draws this person in such a way that we marvel at and maybe empathize with the sentiments, but not entirely share with them. I don't think, hopefully none of us here has sort of laid on the ground and hoped for death. Hopefully that's not quite what we've been across. So there is a passness and a foreignness to these goings-on, an array of emotions, and often a retributional quality administrated by a cruel world that suggests the folk ballad. So now Catherine Lohr will come out and perform with Jiung Yun, the leader eines Fahnenden Gesellen.
Thank you. Thank you.
self-obsessed, looking in at the poet's, the singer's own emotions. And you can tell that from all the exclamations in these songs, right? There's Haya, that outcry of optimism. There's so many Oves in the Kaaba, including the Messer. It's just a huge count of how many Oves there are. Looking very closely, looking inward at the person's own emotions, the singer, the poet, the composer's own emotions. And so self-preoccupied in this way that I think in a real sense the musical ideas everywhere are in a sense subservient to the words of the text. There's not any point really, I think, where the musical ideas aren't attached to things, opportunities coming out of the words. So when we go to the Rückertlieder here from 1901 to 1902, again, these are the lyric Mahler songs. This is the very different kind of stance. Now we're not really looking inward. We are in a more kind of abstract state. Even when there is an ich involved here, ich atmete Lindenduft, liebst du um Schönheit, blicke mir, nicht in die Lieder, when there's a first person in the Rückert songs here, it's an abstract, kind of generalized narrator, not someone as specific as in the Fount of the Gazelle songs. So we move on now to the later Rückert songs and this more abstract state of emotion, the more mature Mahler retreating to lyric poetry and to greater musical subjectivity, I guess we could say. So that's Rückert there on the left. There's Mahler. I've sort of given him a speaking balloon here. Now, it's one of those things that you find so often references to lyric poetry. And personally, I've never found any of these references or even definitions of lyric poetry really satisfying. I finally decided, two things. First of all, it's easier to say what lyric poetry is not than to say what it is. Lyric poems, again, are not epic, they're not narrative, as Aristotle said. Lyric poems don't involve folkloric storytelling. They don't involve explicit imagery. They don't involve stagey drama. They certainly don't involve melodrama. And here, I decided that it's best to come up with my own personal definition of what lyric poetry is, and I decided to say the following for myself, that lyric poems frame a short expanse of language in a way that showcases the beauty inherent in human feeling, whether that feeling is low or high or what have you. So lyric poems frame lovely rather than characteristic emotions, and in doing so invite us to empathize with universal unnamed characters. You could say the lyric is a vein of subjectivity that becomes difficult to share, to communicate with others. That difficulty of these texts results in a certain tone of, what else to call it, abstraction. And indeed, for the poet, the composer, and the listener, lyricism, as heard in Mahler's later works, like the Rückertlieder, proves a more difficult quality to define and penetrate. We can talk about Mahler demonstrating in these later songs virtuosity in some kind of metaphysical or spiritual depiction. And this, in turn, of course, makes these five songs more difficult to interpret and put across than the earlier songs. So all of these ideas, I think, about the lyric poet, the lyric poem, come out in the fact that with these Rückert texts that Mahler chose, there's actually a variety of ways you can set some of these. When we come to Blicke mir nicht in die Lieder, if you just read the words of that poem, it's actually a kind of a paranoid poem. It's suspicious. It's kind of dark. So you can easily imagine a dark, suspicious, sort of foreboding setting of that, but Mahler actually sets it lightheartedly, which might be a surprise for Gustav Mahler. Likewise, well, actually, many of these could certainly be set in different ways, so there's that ambiguity in these particular texts. SoM set. So courtesy of what I oxymoronically here call the subjective abstractions of lyric style, it becomes harder to summarize, also harder to summarize these poems. I think I did a pretty wonderful job of summarizing the Farming Gazelle songs. It's much harder to summarize what's going on here. The first song, Blicke mir nicht in die Lieder, it's a song that thematicizes creation. It's a song that tells you about songwriting. What a very strange thing to write songs about. It makes it, certainly for a heart, makes it hard as a compositional task, but then makes the job harder yet is the fact that the poet is urging attention away from the author's songs, at least until they are finished. So think about it. It's a song, it becomes a song about songwriting, and yet it's a song about songwriting that says don't look at the song. So it's very difficult to compose and also to listen to in that way. So Mahler takes this very strange Rückert text about creativity, even about possibly about paranoia, although he doesn't set it in a paranoid fashion. Instead, he gives it a charming spin. The title line here translates most directly as, "Do not look at my songs." Maybe it's better read, though, as "Do not look at me through my songs," which more accurately renders the implicit warning not to confuse the author and the work. Now, the song here begins with, in the piano with a busy accompanimental passage that suggests coyness and needless toil. Or maybe it might be the bees. The Rückert mentions bees in stanza two. He has the line, "Bees, when they build cells, let no one watch either, and do not even watch themselves." So these might be bees that we're hearing in the pianist's left hand. On the other hand, it might be, the busyness might be the composer who's obsessive and terrified here. Mahler's near rigidity of rhythm hints at obsessiveness. The pauses in the vocal line tend to be awkward and abrupt. Is the person out of breath from labor and worry in writing songs? Or is the rhythm incompetently composed? It might be both. So Blicke mir demonstrates Mahler subverting narrative songfulness and doing all sorts of mind warps there. He sets the more conventional verse, "Ich atme ein Lindenduft," to a swaying, hovering vocal line, largely in 6/4 time, that manages to be both a memorable lyrical idea and an evocative representation of the poem's gentle fragrance, the linden duft that wafts through the air. So the constant eighth notes in the pianist's right hand, which are played by violins in Mahler's orchestral version, become the thread that weaves its way through the entire song, representing maybe the poet's sensory vigilance. Now again, this is a considerable feat in compositional terms. Mahler here is musicalizing an olfactory sense experience. Just think about how would you write a song about smelling something? And that's not an easy task. Compositionally speaking. To prep us here, the song even starts with a gentle aromatic spray in the treble of the piano, so that's the very first thing that we hear, kind of illustrated in that way. Our next song of the group here, which is Mitternacht, is at the center of our chosen sequence of the five. Mitternacht, at midnight. This song is a mystical nocturnal ritual, probably the most ambiguous and difficult to understand of all of the five. And yet it hosts the most dramatic progression of all, from B minor and bare textures and low registers to a blazing B major at the end. And you'll see Gilles doing lots of work here, sort of standing in for harps and brass and a full orchestra. Blazing away in the major key to conclude. Now, what is this midnight that Rückert is talking about? Well, Rückert invokes midnight, Mitternacht, you keep hearing that come back. At midnight, this happens. At midnight, that happens. Rückert has midnight as a time of revelation, of secret things revealed. While the world sleeps, things are revealed. Secrets come out into the open. The great mysteries are solved. And this is much as Friedrich Nietzsche would later write in his mid song from Also Sprach Zarathustra. Mahler had set that text by Nietzsche as the fourth movement of his third symphony. So I hear the Nietzsche text and the Rückert text as kind of companions here. Nietzsche's text here has the line, "Oh humanity, take heed. What does deep midnight say? The world is deep, deeper than the day imagined." So very similar to what Rückert is saying. And then later on, Nietzsche has deep, deep is its woe. And this is much like Rickert's, "At midnight, I fought the battle, O mankind, of your affliction." It's like they're going over similar territory here. And yet Rückert does hugely diverge from Nietzsche, and he arrives at a kind of religious invocation. And Nietzsche was not very keen on religion. Rückert's speaker here gives himself up to the Lord, the Herr, at the end in the last stanza. And in accordance, Mahler traces a progression in mood and coloration from darkness to bright, glorious splendor. So a huge kind of change here over the course of that song. So the fourth song, "Liebst du Unschönheit," this must count as the most coy lied ever written, the most coy love lied, Liebeslied. It is also the second shortest of the set after the first. So what is "Liebst du Unschönheit"? It's actually a list. It's a methodical ticking off of reasons, get this, reasons not to love the author. Right? That's a real twist there. Don't love me if you love for beauty. Don't love me if you love for youth. Don't love me if you love for wealth. I have none of these things. But then finally, in the last stanza, "But yes, please love me if you love for the sake of love alone, because I'm rich, very rich in love." So this Rückert poem here is strophic in a way that highlights its conventional nature as both a love song and a list. And basically, each reason not to love is given the same music. Now, incidentally, Clara V. Schumann set the same text in music in 1841, and a song that follows more early romantic conventional notions of strophic text setting. Mahler aims, contrarily, much more intently for the punchline in the last stanza, namely the changeover from the threefold, "Oh nicht, nicht liebe," to the final, "Oh ja, nicht liebe." So finally, we come to the last of the Rückert settings, "Ich bin der Welt abhanden gekommen." Now, this is hugely representative of subjectivity, of lyricism, of the lyric mindset, of lyric poetry. This is, by general consensus, the most personal of Mahler's later Rückert songs, and actually, by that token, one of his greatest creations. Many people would select this if they had to pick a desert island for Mahler's song. And this text here right away declares the lyric subjective mindset from the opening lines. "Ich bin der Welt abhanden gekommen. I am lost to the world where I used to waste much time. It has for so long known nothing of me, it may well believe that I am dead." So this is incredible retreat from worldly things and from being present in the tumult, as it later happens, of the world and its activities. So here Mahler suggests otherworldliness right away with this slow rhythmic stability. The score direction is extremely slowly and hesitatingly. The second adverb here, hesitatingly, indicates character and not rhythmic inconsistency. The text deals, this very difficult text deals in inhibition. So retreat, also inhibition, and that's also very hard to set to music. The text communicates even some measure of apology. "Ich kann auch gar nichts sagen dagegen." I cannot deny it. The writer and singer not discouraging the conclusion here that reclusiveness, although it becomes the salvation of the poet and the singer, is also actually an ungenerous inclination. Retreating is kind of a selfish act. And you can hear the sense of inhibition in the rather beautifully hazy intervals of the song, with many major sevenths and major sixths. So, summarize it, the earlier narrative epic style of the Fauna and Gazelle songs, which we heard Catherine perform, if these songs look outward, this example of their poetic style very much looks inward. The Ich bin der Welt text is an example of lyric poetry that broaches nothing other than pure subjectivity. As Mahler himself suggested, this poetry is solely and essentially lyric. It invokes no sense of time. It introduces no characters. Just who is this person saying these words and singing this music? Who is this anonymous and sexless first-person descriptor of the retreating self? Knowing the answer would get in the way of the song's message, or as is more likely, the narrator's anonymity is part of the message. It is, paradoxically enough, a very brave and very forthright song about retreat. So now we will hear Kimberly Monson and Hyun Yoon performing the five Rickert. Thank you.